the closest that we've come in recent times is someone like Muhammad Ali. She was never afraid to speak out, to be who she was. But then maybe it's because she was coming from this cultural mecca that was the Harlem Renaissance.
The beam in your eyes, the smile on your face.
Her body was democracy's body. And she was all of the modernist art, poetry, and music movements rolled into one black dancing body.
The loveliness of you.
She is one of the most famous symbols of the jazz age. She stood for a certain kind of liberation for black people.
The loveliness of you.
Mm. The astonishing bravery of this little girl who came from less than nothing and became the most famous woman in the world.
Beautiful, complicated, impossible, courageous Josephine. She lived many lives and invented many personas, but none were as enduring as Josephine Baker, the most sensational woman anybody ever saw or ever will. The woman who was to explode taboos on race and sexuality wherever she went was born in St. Louis in 1906 and grew up illegitimate, largely uneducated, and poor. These were volatile times. America was deeply segregated. Whites enshrined their supremacy in laws, the Jim Crow laws.
I was taught to believe that I was inferior, like many, many colored peoples of the world who are taught every day to feel inferior to white people.
She must have been 13 at the time of the riots in East St. Louis. She saw all the people fleeing across the Mississippi on the bridge coming over. I think that made a very big impression on her. Even when her career seemed to take her very far from black people or from the interests of black people, I think within her was always the sense that she was representing her people and being true to her past.
There were few escape routes for children like Josephine, but she seized every opportunity. Marriage was one. And by the time she left her second husband, Willie Baker, at the age of 15, she had discovered another. Show business. Josephine danced her way out of St. Louis on the grueling black vaudeville circuit.
It was a very rough circuit. Basic tent was set up often in a clearing or a hollow on the edge of the town. This is where blacks could go for these sort of weekend entertainments. They were a famously difficult audience. If they loved you, they really loved you. If they didn't, they really didn't. And so I think that her high spirits and her energy sort of conquered this circuit. She was clearly sort of born to stand out.
By the time Josephine arrived in New York in 1921, a creative maelstrom was erupting across the city in the dazzling array of black talent and ambition later defined as the Harlem Renaissance. And she was about to make the most of it.
The big influence in the early part of her career was when she was with a group who called themselves the Dixie Steppers. And from there, of course, she then got a place in the touring version of the famous Cecil and Blake show, Shuffle Along, which was one of the seminal shows of the 1920s in America. It was something that really had a huge impact and ran for a long time.
I'm just wild about Harry, and Harry's wild about me.
If black performers wanted to play in mixed theatres, they had to black up. The audience then presumed they were white. Paradoxically, on occasion, they also had to lighten up.
Everything ultimately in American performance revolves largely around issues of race. In Shuffle Along in New York in 1921, all of the chorus girls in the black musicals all looked like they were white, but they were all black. And Baker was small, she was darker than the rest of the girls, was not considered attractive, and she already was doing her special stuff at the end of the line.
Now this is part of the tradition in black vaudeville. The chorus girls always had on the end of the line a comedy chorus girl. They would come on singing their song, and she couldn't get the step. She wouldn't be in step with the other girls, and she'd be making faces and so on. But then when they did the encore and they came back on again, then she'd have got the step, and she'd be doing it better than the other girls, turning cartwheels, doing the splits, and just, you know, breaking the place up.
She was pointed out, actually, in one of the reviews as, whoever she is, this is the woman whose legs have no bones, who, you know, apparently she has charisma. And she had charisma even at an early age.
After a year or so with the show, she started to have her own individual billing. She was called That Comedy Chorus Girl, and then later on, the highest paid chorus girl in the world. So although later in life she always said she had not established herself in America, she had established herself in a small way there. I mean, the moment she sort of put her foot out, she started to get noticed.
Part of the luck of her career is that as the Harlem Renaissance was taking off, so was Josephine Baker. So when she decided, I don't want to be married to Willie Baker anymore, I want to be in that show, in a way, she'd caught the new Negro fever.
Despite the attention Josephine was starting to receive, she sensed she had progressed as far as a black woman could in 1920s America. So when she was offered the opportunity to join an all-black revue show opening in Paris, she jumped at the chance. Summoning all her courage, she was only 19, she sailed to Europe for the first time.
1925, wasn't it, when you went to Paris, first of all? What was Josephine Baker like in 1925?
Josephine Baker at that moment was a very frightened girl. Yes, frightened because, you see, there were special reasons for that fright, the uncertainty. Josephine Baker was the girl who left St. Louis to come to Europe to find freedom.
Josephine Baker would never have gotten anywhere with her dance in Revue Nègre in 1925 New York, whereas it turned 1925 Paris on its head.
Imagine what it must have been like when she arrived in France, where this all-black review, they're just checked into a hotel, just normal hotel. There are no black hotels, it's just people. They can go to any restaurant they want. Can you imagine? They are considered exotic flowers, not prejudice. Well, I'm just amazed that every one of them didn't stay in France for the rest of their lives.
In France, there were no Jim Crow laws. In fact, there was a desire on the part of the French to embrace all things African.
The French were colonizing Africa at the time. The majority of people genuinely believed they were doing good things. And so Negro art was very popular.
In 1925, just months before La Revue Nègre, we had had the great Art Deco exhibition. So you have artists who are showing a great deal of interest in African art. And then somebody like Josephine comes along, and they think that that somehow is the sculpture from their paintings that have come to life.
During rehearsals, Josephine quickly caught the attention of the producers of La Revue Nègre, and they partnered her with a male dancer for a sensationally erotic duet, and, with some difficulty, persuaded her to appear as if she were naked.
She grappled with it maybe overnight and decided, okay, this is what needs to be done, I will do it. So there's something very opportunistic about her personality.
There's no film of La Revue Nègre. We can't really know what it looked like or what the dance was like. But it was something that people hadn't seen before. Joey Alex, who was her dancing partner, carried her onto the stage on his back. She was lying on his back doing the splits in the air. And then he gently let her down, and she turned a sort of slow cartwheel onto the stage and stood there. In Janet Flanner's famous account years later, like a magnificent ebony statue.
Josephine made her entrance entirely nude. She was wearing nothing but a pink flamingo feather. A scream of salutation spread through the theater.
No longer the comedy chorus girl, Josephine, for the first time in her life, felt beautiful.
She became a star overnight, and, you know, just like in all the legends, and that's what happened to her. But she was able to deal with it. Josephine was a really great performer, great artist. She was able to deal with it.
Some people were absolutely outraged by those black ladies showing themselves almost completely nude on stage, dancing in a way which was very provocative, and Josephine Baker was the best of them all.
It was like Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. It just set people crazy, and some people thought this was like the end of European civilization as we know it, you know, and the battlefield being Josephine Baker's bum.
Yes, you, you're driving me crazy. What did I do, what did I do? My tears for you make everything crazy.
That black dancing body stood in stark contrast to the monarchical, hierarchical, vertically aligned body of European ballet. She disrupted that picture with all of the movements that actually go right back to minstrelsy. The shimmy, the mouche, the mess around, the Charleston, all of these things which in the European mode would be considered awkward, become beautiful, sexy, silly, and savvy all at the same time.
You have to think of Josephine Baker as a symbol that the Jazz Age and the Harlem Renaissance could share, that in some ways the white and the black wings of this artistic movement that we could call modernism could sort of meet in her as a symbol.
Josephine's impact stretched way beyond the theater. She entranced and inspired a generation of writers and artists in Paris, including Picasso, Hemingway, Colette, and Simenon. Alexander Calder sculpted wire models of her, and Gertrude Stein composed an affectionate tribute. As her fame spread, her lifestyle grew increasingly exotic. She acquired a passion for expensive gifts and a menagerie of pets, including a baby cheetah. She also became a symbol of sexual liberation, uninhibited in her choice of lovers, both male and female, and reveling in her sensual, beautiful, dancing body.
There was a lot of manipulation, I think, taking place in how her initial performance was fashioned. But having said that, I think that Josephine enjoyed the attention and she responded well to the opportunity that she'd been given.
Blue sky, smiling at me, nothing but blue sky.
First Paris, then Europe, as Josephine took La Revue Nègre on tour, causing a sensation wherever she went. Her notorious reputation as a diva was born when she reneged on her contract and returned to France, having been offered more money to headline at the famous Folies Bergères.
In her first show at the Folies Bergères, she did this number with which she was associated for the rest of her life, the famous banana dance.
The banana girdle is so very interesting, and a question as to who came up with the costume. It seems like she contributed a lot to the idea. And with her doing all those kind of movements that I'm describing, you can imagine that banana girdle going all over the place. And it's like phalluses, you know, stimulated by female agency. So, I mean, again, you can look at it from the outside and think, oh, this is just a shake dancer. But if you look at it from the inside, again, it's this incredible female personality that is in possession of the male.
The thing about the banana dance, of course, is that it's funny. It's a riot, and you could see that, you know, people were falling about laughing and amazed and excited, and they'd never seen anything like it before. And she danced it everywhere she went, all over the world. In every city, there was a new version of the banana dance. It went to Berlin, it went to Vienna, it went to Buenos Aires, it went to Rio. And for the rest of her life, you only needed to draw somebody with a little banana skirt, and everybody knew it was Josephine Baker. You didn't have to say who it was.
But was Josephine merely perpetuating a stereotype, or was she subverting it?
She's never the victim of the stereotype. She's laughing through it all. She is making fun of the stereotype. She approaches the White Hunter laughing, offers herself sexually laughing, moves away laughing, and then goes into another thing, sticks out her bum, and then walks off. That's the end. So also that kind of quick cutting of an end, sticks out her bum, and then walks off. I see attitude in that, you know, right?
Her ability to dance just created a sensation that stuck in the minds of people, particularly for the French. It was very much, strangely enough, part of their sense of being modern again, regaining this lost innocence. And so Josephine in a banana skirt, gyrating and expressing her sexuality in such a free way, was extremely exciting and almost therapeutic for them.
In a way, Josephine Baker was the black woman every white guy could fantasize about sleeping with. She certainly had that function in France for French men, because this image of the available, smiling, not menacing, not dangerous, not voodoo-practicing black woman had been in French popular literature for some time, because it went with French colonialism.
Paris, 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 c'est sur la terre un coin de paradis. Paris, 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 de mes amours, c'est lui le favori.
She exported the Harlem Renaissance to Europe. And for her to do that at that time, and do it so quickly, she moved to Paris, and 2 years later, she was the highest paid and most photographed woman in the world. That's amazing.
Under the guiding influence of her new lover, Pepito Abatino, Josephine blossomed into a sophisticated all-round entertainer. As he shaped her career and image, she became a role model for French women.
C'est votre beau bijou d'un goût exquis.
She had a weekly column in the newspapers and various magazines, high fashion magazines, because she had her hair, what they used to call marcelled, absolutely flat to her head, so it looked like she had a skull cap. So there was great controversy. Front page headlines, does Josephine Baker shave her hair, and is that painted on? Is that actually her hair? How can we get it? French society women wanted the Josephine Baker look.
Beautiful, marvelous, simply adorable baby.
It's a long way from East St. Louis to Parisienne Café Society, but Josephine, in her own inimitable way, had made it.
I think what she came to terms with was that there was something about her as a black woman which was very appreciated, but she also needed to adapt to the French audience. And that, I think, was her skill, her ability to be flexible and to respond to her audience's needs.
She had some help and some allies, but you do get the feeling throughout her life and career that she was pretty much on her own. And her vulnerability never went away. But, you know, she had a kind of heroic exhibitionism. And courage. I think she had a lot of physical bravery. And that went a lot. A lot of that went into her style of dancing.
In 1927, she began singing and recording. She even starred in several films, another first for a black woman at that time. With Abatino's guidance, she opened her own nightclub, Chez Josephine, where anyone who was anyone flocked to see and be seen.
She was a natural, gifted person, and she sang not great. Again, she didn't have any training, really, but she sang naturally. She had a soprano voice, a bit light, and she had accents, which French people loved, of course. You know, she got away with murdering the French language, and they loved it. It was absolutely fantastic.
Her recorded musical career spanned nearly 50 years, from 1926, when she made her first recordings in Paris, right through to the legacy of her final farewell concert at Carnegie Hall. During that time, this small, pure voice became deeper in range. It took on a more mezzo quality, nothing unusual in that. And she perhaps lent a little more character to her singing than when she started out. But then she was only 20, 21 when she made her first records.
Mon amour chéri, plein de jalousie. Tu veux que je te prouve que mon cœur te partient? Ou veux-tu que je trouve les phrases qui prouvent ce que déjà.
I think she's more a personality, a full woman, than a singer. You wouldn't say, you know, she's a Maria Callas of the French chanson. But everybody knows her. You can't go anywhere without her in studying the French chanson. Her songs are, haven't got a message, or very rarely. They are just nice, and it's her personality that the French admired.
Vernon Duke, who'd written the big hit April in Paris, knew the limitations of her voice and wrote correspondingly for her, and this included giving her little coloratura passages where she could run from middle C up two octaves and back again in a sort of wordless vocal line, which was one of her specialities. And a lot of her numbers, like J'ai deux amours, actually have that written into the score.
J'ai deux amours seemed to sum up Josephine Baker's life, written especially for her, Two Loves Have I, My Country and Paris. It became her anthem.
For Josephine's contemporaries, her achievement was unbelievable. She became one of the most famous women in the world, and she was the first black actor to star in an international movie. La Sirène des Tropiques, her first big film, silent film, of course, name above the title, that's a major first. And people in America were very, very impressed by that. And that film was given a gala premiere up in Harlem when it opened in New York. And of course, everything she did was followed in the black American press back home. They were very, very interested always to know what Josie Baker was up to in Europe.
Having taken on the rest of the world, Josephine was ready to go home, back to America, to show them what she'd become.
Josephine had had 10 years of adulation in Europe and in South America, and of fame and of success. And she was invited to take part in the Ziegfeld Follies in New York. Josephine was the first and the last black girl ever to star in the Ziegfeld Follies. When she got back to New York in 1935, what she found was that things were worse then than they'd been when she left. She was allowed to book a room in a smart hotel on Park Avenue, but only on condition that she entered through the servants' entrance at the back.
It looked promising enough. Josephine was starring alongside Bob Hope and Fanny Brice. As well as a version of the banana dance, she performed songs written for her by Ira Gershwin and Vernon Duke, and she was choreographed by George Balanchine. But she did not use a microphone, and her small voice was lost in such a large venue. Worse, her final dance proved unexpectedly controversial and reminded her of why she'd left America in the first place. Four men danced with her in a dream sequence.
Of course, they are four white men. And this really, I don't think, had been done on stage before in New York, and people were shocked by it. And it was one of the things that had led to her film, Princess Tam Tam, being banned outright in America because it showed her having a romance with her white leading man. The critics of that Ziegfeld show wrote about her in a most extraordinarily virulent way in the white press. There's one notorious one in particular in Time magazine where they refer to her as a buck-toothed Negro wench.
America had this kind of distrust of the outside, and blacks then who went to Europe and were a success in Europe, meaning just that they stayed. They may not even have been a success, but the fact that they stayed made them suspect when they came back to the U.S. because it was such a rejection or a criticism of U.S. racial policy to live abroad.
I had some very bad experiences. I suppose it's for that reason that I can understand other people's problems and humiliations. You see, one day, among many, I was coming out of a hotel, and I met a white lady. She was coming into the hotel, and she stopped and she spat on me. Of course, I felt the tears rolling down my eyes, down behind my cheeks, but I didn't answer her because, of course, it was not very important. I knew it wasn't her fault. She had been taught like that.
She was breaking new ground as an entertainer for black women. She was also putting out there a very sexualized interpretation of what black women were, and in a very modern way.
Just as France was very receptive to this sexual image and embraced it, the Americans were very against it. You really could not have a black sexual star. You couldn't have it.
I think Langston Hughes' poem about looking for a house in the world where white shadows do not fall is such a poignant one, particularly for black people and for black performers, because you find that you're always having to operate within the context of white society and its dictates. And it would be nice to think that there might be an arena where your talents would be viewed without that kind of overlay.
Si loin de mon pays, de l'homme oui j'ai vécu.
It was the greatest professional disappointment of her career, the failure of that appearance at the Ziegfeld Follies, and it coincided with a personal tragedy because Albertino went back to France while she was appearing in the show, and he hadn't told her, but he was dying of cancer, and by the time she went back to France, he was dead. And by the time she went back to France, she knew she couldn't go back to America. There was nothing for her there. She wasn't going to star in any more shows there. She wasn't going to be offered any movie contracts there. She wasn't going to be allowed to achieve any of the things that she dreamt of. When she got back to Paris, Paul Deval from the Folies Bergère was waiting at the station with a huge crowd of fans and an accordionist and a bunch of flowers, and they welcomed her back to France.
How can I forget it? Well, they made me forget the color of my skin.
Yes.
All of my good friends, they were white.
After her primitivist phase, when she was more in the 30s, you could call it expressionism, something like that, and a slightly different image, more elegant, more sophisticated and urbane. I think the French public and began to think of her more in sort of music hall terms, like Piaf and people like that, and not black jazz singers and black blues singers. And again, I think it's because she had no American career in that sense.
I got a message from the man in the moon for you.
In November 1937, Josephine married the affluent businessman Jean Lyon. He was Jewish and the son of wealthy industrialists. Though their backgrounds were worlds apart, they shared a common experience of racial prejudice. She renounced her American citizenship and became a French national. It was her third marriage, and like the previous two, short and not always sweet. Jean Lyon wanted a full-time wife, but at 31, Josephine could not and would not give up the stage. When she suffered a miscarriage, the strain distanced them further. And eventually they parted.
Watching her dance, I felt it was escapism. Because I know sometimes I feel like that when I'm on stage. The pain does not exist. Everyone out there is one. And you try to please, and at the same time you try to drive away your pain. And your pain, you drive away your pain through dancing. Dancing does that. That's the beauty of dancing. He said dancing is quite therapeutic.
And then there were darker clouds on the horizon.
When the war came, her position was very clear. She had renounced her American citizenship when she married Jean Lyon, so she was French. She didn't want to go back to America anyway. She appeared in a show in the autumn of 1939 at the Casino, co-starring with Maurice Chevalier. But once the German invasion of France was underway, by June 1940, she retreated to Les Milandes.
Les Milandes was Joséphine's chateau in the Dordogne. It was here she was introduced to Jacques Apty and the embryonic resistance movement. Impressed by her passion for her adopted homeland, Apty recruited Joséphine to work with him in counter-espionage. She repaid his faith with her courage.
Joséphine, I think, was already well in touch with people surrounding de Gaulle, people who were laying the foundations of what would become the Résistance, and she gave everything to them. She gave them the house to use, she gave them her car, her plane, her money. More than anything else, she gave them her fame, because they were able to travel with her undercover, because they traveled with her as her band, and so they could move around.
Smuggle information, to make friends with the German officers. That's true courage. She obviously grew to love the French. She grew to love the French.
In France, Joséphine was too conspicuous to be of active use to the resistance, but abroad, it was a different matter. She and Apty embarked upon several hazardous journeys, smuggling reports from the military on the position of German troops in her music sheets. In 1941, she left France and would not return for four long years.
When all of France was invaded, she went to North Africa, Morocco, where then she had a very bad time physically. She got very sick. I don't know if she thought she was going to die, but certainly people around her thought she was going to die.
When the Americans landed in Casablanca in November 1942, as Joséphine lay seriously ill with peritonitis, her death was officially announced. It's possible that her reported demise was for her own protection, since she'd gathered information to assist the Allied invasion. Whatever the reasoning, it was patently untrue. Joséphine spent the remainder of the war entertaining the troops.
Doing the troop shows for the American forces and the British forces gave her the opportunity to do what she'd always wanted to do, and she said, I will not sing in front of a segregated audience. They've got to be mixed. You've got to let the black people come down to the front row.
It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary, to the sweetest girl I know.
In the Second World War, she revived on disc two of the great songs of the First World War, Tipperary and If You Were the Only Girl in the World and I Were the Only Boy.
But my heart's right
there. I think it was a flight of imagination to do that, because these were the songs that the French and, of course, the English fighting forces remembered who she was entertaining at that time.
During the war, Joséphine was awarded the Croix de Lorraine for her support of the Free French Army and the honorary rank of sub-lieutenant in the French Air Force, a uniform she was to wear with great pride for the rest of her life. In 1946, again seriously ill in hospital, she was honored with the Médaille de Résistance. Later, she also received the Légion d'Honneur.
Lots of people, of course, thought Joséphine was dead because her death had been announced during the war. So she made her first appearance in Paris quite quickly after the liberation at a gala performance for the Air Force charities. And she was accompanied for that by Joe Bouillon and his orchestra. And Joe came into her life that night, and not long afterwards they married, and he became the next sort of important anchor in her life. He was a very good musician, had his own band, very, very nice man. And with him, she found a sort of security and a sort of life that she'd never had the chance to have before.
After the turmoil and trauma of the war years, she returned with her new husband to the peace and quiet of Les Milandes. Josephine's plans to turn the chateau into a tourist centre began to take shape as she poured money into the estate. But despite her desire for a more settled life, she still yearned to perform.
In 1949, she returned in triumph to the Folies Bergères, no longer the personality she'd been before, but doing a rather different type of song, lots of South American songs in the modern style. And then in one of the sketches, in one of the tableaux in the show, she did, for the second part of her Paris career, gave herself an image, which in a way is the opposite end of the spectrum from the Josephine in Bananas. She appeared as Mary, Queen of Scots. And this really knocked people sideways, and it was a very big, spectacular sequence, which ended up, of course, with Mary Stuart's execution. And right after that, Josephine reappeared behind a stained glass window singing Schubert's Ave Maria. If only we could see this. But it was a wonderful success, and in a way it put her back on the Paris scene. But again, as I said, in this different persona, she was now the grande dame.
After the war and her experiences in Africa and the change seen in Paris itself and her new status as a kind of French heroine, a heroine of the resistance, gave her an authority and a confidence to talk about matters in the U.S. that she maybe hadn't had before.
I'm feeling like a million.
In 1951, Josephine was offered an engagement at a Miami nightclub. Despite being offered $10,000 a week, she refused unless she could perform to a non-segregated audience. The management eventually agreed, and the show was a sellout. Her success led to a nationwide tour where she played to mixed audiences and rave reviews. She had finally made it in her own country, and doing it on her own terms made it all the sweeter. 100,000 people joined her in New York to celebrate when the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People named her the most outstanding woman of the year and declared the 20th of May Josephine Baker Day.
My going back to Harlem, I'll never forget that day. All the peoples of Harlem were out to greet me. They were accepting and accepting me as one of their sisters coming back who had succeeded to make mankind recognize colored peoples as dignified people.
One of the banners saying, I noticed, Josephine Baker, toast of two continents.
Oh, well.
Very nice.
Growing up in the 1950s, in a very repressive era in America, the McCarthy era, and a very repressive era for African Americans, Josephine Baker was like our escape. And interestingly enough, we didn't really know anything specific about her. We had not seen her movies, but we knew these really important things, that she was black and lived in Paris, that she was rich and wore beautiful over-the-top clothes and jewels, and that she spoke French fluently. So she was a wonderful kind of ideal, certainly for my family.
Both professionally and personally, Josephine finally had it all. She was happily married, earning $20,000 a week, and booked up for the next 6 months. Yet within days, everything she had worked so hard to achieve was destroyed.
This sort of one-woman battle that she took on led to this very celebrated incident at the Stork Club in New York. Now, the Stork Club was this very, very smart, exclusive club. She went in there with a group of friends one night to have dinner. They ordered dinner, they ordered a bottle of wine, and nothing came. They waited for an hour, and she left in a state of some considerable pique or anger. And as she was leaving, she stopped to talk to Walter Winchell. Walter Winchell was a very famous newspaper columnist. She knew him well, and he had written about her in a sympathetic way. But in the sort of brouhaha that followed, and there were lots of letters to the press, and she lodged an official complaint against the club, saying that they had discriminated against her because of her color, she somehow included Winchell in her complaint and said that he should have come to her aid. You have to remember, this is 1951 in America. This is at the height of the McCarthy era, the height of the red-baiting, you know, communist-fearing era. Winchell turned against her. He turned his column against her. He accused her of being a communist. He unleashed this torrent of hate against her in the gutter press, which resulted in her losing her contracts for all the clubs she was appearing in. And she had her visa taken away. Remember, of course, she was no longer American, she was French. And she wasn't allowed to re-enter the United States for another 9 years.
Dans ce grand Paris, si loin de mon pays.
She said the Eiffel Tower looked very different from the Statue of Liberty, but then what was the use of the statue without the liberty? She was talking about the sort of legislation that was in place in America at the time. That made it very, very difficult for black performers, for black people, period, to live a free life.
Throughout her life, Josephine demonstrated a naive attitude to politics, which often landed her in trouble. On the rebound from the disastrous American experience, she flew to Argentina, where she described Perón's regime as an enlightened democracy. Realizing her mistake and thoroughly disillusioned, she returned to France. Determined to show the world that people of different races could coexist, Josephine entered the most demanding and rewarding phase of her life. She adopted 12 orphans from around the world and christened her new family the Rainbow Tribe. It proved to be a momentous financial challenge, which she struggled with for the rest of her life.
My little village, this little village of the world, was badly in need of financial support. So I came back on the stage to make it possible for it to live on and on and on, because it is very important, that little village it is. I have a lot of little children from the four corners of the world who live there. They are a symbol of true brotherhood. I must have the money for these children. The Milan must live. It must not die. This village is too important. It represents a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful ideal. And the ideal must not die. It mustn't.
The more you know about her pain, her background, the more you understand why she felt she could get all these children who are, in a sense, being abandoned like she was, and bring them together and give them the love she never had. Oh, that's so easy to understand that.
Je sais qu'un jour ils chanteront. J'ai deux amours.
She was not a businesswoman. You know, as we see in French, her heart was on her hand, so she would give money to people who asked for it, good causes or conmen. She was just couldn't cope, and she had to go and beg for money to help carry on bringing up her children, and I think they sort of all were looked after pretty well, but she had great difficulties with the taxman. She wrote to Valéry Giscard d'Estaing when he was Minister of Finance, saying, well, Valéry, what are you asking me money for? I'm doing a good thing. You know, you should give me money, not me giving it to you, you know, that sort of thing.
Although for a while Les Milandes proved to be a great success as a tourist attraction, Josephine always spent more than she earned. And as she desperately tried to keep the estate and her family afloat, the strain took its toll. Her marriage failed. Bouillon left, unable to cope with her increasingly autocratic behaviour, although he remained close to the children. And despite working tirelessly, the debts continued to overwhelm her.
I think people were a little bit ashamed that such a lady was in that situation, and a lot of people with not much money would help her. Some very rich people help her. But the state, France being a centralized government, you would think that's an institution like Joséphine Baker and her chateau at Limoilou should have been held by the state.
Her health deteriorated, and she suffered several strokes and heart attacks as she continued to fight an unwinnable battle. Finally, she lost her beloved chateau. After a dramatic final day on the steps, she collapsed and was taken to hospital.
Tito of Yugoslavia offered her an island to bring up a little colony, but she said, no, I want to stay in France. And, you know, the Princess Grace of Monaco offered to help her and give her a villa as well, and that sort of thing. So she was, but she had to, which meant that she had to work all the time until she died.
After the upheavals of the past few years, Joséphine and the children settled into a more stable existence in Monaco. The Rainbow Tribe grew up and away from Joséphine, making new lives for themselves. Despite the ups and downs, Joséphine's desire to show the world that people could coexist no matter what their color or creed had proved successful. She returned to the States for the largest civil rights demonstration in American history, the 1963 March on Washington. Joséphine, who had fought her own lonely battles for equality, was visibly moved by the progress that had finally been made and addressed the crowd wearing her uniform. Although she continued to be part of the movement, Joséphine was considered out of step by the more militant members who didn't recognize the stand she'd taken a decade before. Despite her health continuing to deteriorate, she carried on performing throughout the last decade of her life. She cut an unusual figure in the swinging 60s, her outfits growing ever more extravagant and her appearance increasingly camp. La petite Tonkinoise, c'est moi qui suis sa petite. Son nanana, son nanana, son amie. Je suis vive, je suis charmante, comme un petit oiseau qui chante. Il m'appelle sa petite bourgeoise, sa tonkiki, sa tonkiki, sa tonkinoise. D'autres lui font les doux yeux, mais c'est moi qui l'aime le mieux. Soir en cause. She saved her greatest theatrical triumph for her final years, a farewell to both the countries she'd loved. Dans ses bras, il me parle tout bas, viande. In America, she played four sell-out shows at New York's Carnegie Hall. And 18 months later, in April 1975, she returned to the Parisian stage for the first time in 6 years. It was now 50 years since she'd first arrived in Paris as a 19-year-old chorus girl, and the show celebrated her achievement. The songs she sang were the songs of her life.
I saw this magic moment in showbiz history the very last time Josephine Baker appeared on stage.
And now, the end is near.
The whole place erupted, of course, when she came on, and it was that strange thing which you cannot see on film, it cannot be caught on a record, it's something that only theatre people do. She just shot 1,000 volts through the audience.
I've lived a life that's full.
What you get is the, as they say in French, parfum. You get the flavor of the woman by the expectations you bring to it, the knowledge you bring to it, this amazingly preserved body that just suggested discipline and training and showbiz down to the fingertips. Her surrounded by the glamour and the glitz, these young dancers swirling, and then this magnificent animal, tall, beautifully thin, and this costume. It was a cat suit, down to here with the sleeves, down to there, high heels up to there, the headdress, the whole thing. And underneath it, a woman of steel and panther-like grace, still. That was quite amazing, quite amazing. She was unique.
I did it my way.
The show was booked up for weeks in advance. Josephine opened to ecstatic reviews on April the 8th, 1975. At the age of 68, she said she felt 17 again. The following night, after the performance, she suffered a final stroke and never regained consciousness. As a decorated war hero, Josephine was accorded a full-scale 21-gun salute state funeral. The only woman of American birth to be so honored.
I kept on doing my work.
Josephine Baker was a street dancer. How relevant is that today? How relevant? How many kids do we now see on the street with no training, just biologically needing an outlet to express themselves through dance? She is relevant through the ages, and most especially for today.
I think that we can give her credit for standing the test of time, of riding the wave of her initial popularity and developing a personality and also a sense of integrity, political integrity, that would, in the long term, give her great credit.
I think her lasting contribution was that she offered her beautiful body to the stage and to the black and white public, so that the image of the black was transformed to thunderous applause. You know, this moving, shining, beautiful girl.
Ambitious golden eagle hunting a red deer and a search for Britain's largest spider. We're watching the wildlife with Bilotti next here on BBC Two. And tomorrow at 7, one man's crusade against terrible restaurants, the Bad Food Guide.